starting in verse 2.
Consider it all joy,
my brethren,
when you encounter various trials,
knowing
that the testing of your faith produces endurance. And let endurance have its perfect result, so that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing.
Okay. Habakkuk chapter 4. Sorry. Chapter 3. And verse 18. Verse 17.
I think this is a bit of a famous passage. Nevertheless,
though the fig tree should not blossom and there be no fruit on the vines, though the yield of the olive should fail and the fields produce no food, though the flock should be cut off from the fold and there be no cattle in the stalls, yet I will exult in the Lord. I will rejoice in the God of my salvation. The Lord God is my strength, and he has made my feet like hinds' feet and makes me walk on my high places.
Okay, let's just pray before we continue. Father, again, I thank you for the help of your presence, that your spirit is indeed present and moving among us. And so now I ask you to give me utterance in the opening of my mouth and at the same time set a guard over it, that we might hear from heaven. I thank you that you made an appointment with every person who is here and every person who will be hearing this through whatever means, that you have made an appointment with them so that they could get help. And we just ask you, Father, for that, that each person would take what you are giving to them, that it would save them. Father, your words are life. Your words are life. Help us to eat it, that it would become the joy and rejoicing of our souls. Help us to eat, that we are sustained in the face of every kind of adversity, every kind of accusation, every kind of difficulty. For your will is life, and life abundantly flowing in us and through us, that others would see God would rescue anyone. So we just thank you for that. Take what Jesus has purchased that we are in need of today. Take what is ours because Jesus purchased it for us, and work it into us in this time, Father. And whatever is not of you, whatever is just my own words and thoughts, just blow them away and make them of no because what we need is what you have for us this morning. So speak to us in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Okay. So again, I'm going to try and keep our time together short in this word. Last week, we were talking about considering it. Well, we took the title from the beginning of James. Consider it all joy. Okay? I want to continue to talk with you about it. when Zach was here, our friend Zach from England was here. He was ministering to us things that had to do with how salvation actually works out in our life. Okay? There are certain things that we need to come to grips with. And one of the most important is that the will of God in your life does not automatically work out. I know that it is a controversial idea in the church larger, that there are many of our brothers and sisters who have the thought that if something is the will of God, then it will be done. Because who can oppose God? Who can oppose God? Well, you know what? The reality is that though there may be certain matters that nobody can oppose God, it's going to come to pass. There is a lot of stuff that you can oppose God.
I would never oppose God. Yeah.
Every place where God says one thing and you think something else is a place where you oppose it. Right? It's really that simple. God says, did somebody, let's take an example from the book of Corinthians. In the book of Corinthians, Paul is dealing with all sorts of issues in a wild and wacky church. And one of the things that comes up is that brother is taking brother to court. Okay? Don't misread this. The idea here is not that you should not go to court or anything like that. But the idea is this. One brother has been injured by the other party, and so they're going to court with each other. And Paul asks this ridiculous question. This ridiculous question. Have you been wronged?
Yes. That's the problem here.
And then Paul says, why not be wrong?
What?
Maybe there's something more valuable available than your justice being rendered. And so he simply implies, why don't you forgive? Is there anybody in here who is aware that God has said to each one of us, forgive? Anybody aware of that? Okay. Now a little more painful question. Is there anybody in here who there has not forgiven somebody immediately? Okay. Okay. I'm saying, okay, so if you know that God says forgive, so somebody comes and does something nasty to you, and let's not, I don't want to trivialize this, terrible things have happened to people, okay? Terrible things have been done to other people. And God, without endorsing that, still says, forgive. Forgive them. Now, if God says it, our reaction should be, right, done. But I know from my own experience and from listening to other people speak, that's not always our first reaction when something happens to us. Are you with me? So, why did you not forgive? Why do you not forgive? I'm not trying to imply that there are things that you're still holding, but thinking back to a time when you did not forgive somebody, why not? You had some good reason, okay? Some compelling reason in your mind that said, I'm not gonna forgive. You were opposing God. And the result of that is a door gets open for your adversary to come in and mess your life up even more. Okay? So that's just an illustration. I'm not so much talking about forgiveness today, as much as I want to illustrate the fact that we do oppose God. And therefore, the will of God does not always get done. It is essential that we reject the idea that if God wants something, it'll automatically happen. You know, the reasoning behind that way of thinking that says, if it's God's will, it will automatically get done, leads to bizarre conclusions like, God is the author of sin. God is the one who made the devil do all the things that he does. God wanted Adam and Eve to fall. Because otherwise, how could it happen? How could it happen? How could there be sin in the world if God did not want it? What an absolutely outrageous, ludicrous conclusion. You know, if you think about logic and how people reason with one another, there's a way of reasoning that says, if you come to a ridiculous conclusion, that's proof that your reasoning is wrong. Okay? If you keep reasoning and the conclusion is outrageous, like absurd, then you know this is false. This is a false reason. Yet, people come to false conclusions about God and continually happily on. It makes no sense. We have to stand against the idea that the will of God automatically works. There's not a single person in the sound who can hear my voice through whatever means. There's not a single person that God does not want 100% whole, healthy, well. Okay? When God says things like peace to you, he's not simply saying, nobody bother you. He's not simply saying that all the mosquitoes die. When he says peace to you, it is more than don't be anxious. He is saying, be whole. One person, I'm not sure who said it, but it wasn't me, defined peace as nothing broken, nothing missing in your life. That's what God wants for every single one of us. But our response to him determines how much of that works out. It is very important that we come to grips with that. I am not saying that we save ourselves. No, absolutely not. The idea behind we save ourselves is that by through our activities, we somehow convince God to do something for us. Okay? By our good behavior, by our reading our Bible every day, by praying every day, by not choking my boss when I think that's the appropriate thing. By not doing that, God then says, okay, I'll throw you a bone. That is not what we're talking about. What we're talking about is this. God has already granted it all. He is not withholding one single thing from you or from me. Okay? Whatever may still be broken or missing in your life, God is not withholding it. God is not withholding it. It is all available. But we must take it by faith. We must walk with Him by faith. The book of Philippians says, work out your salvation in fear and trembling, i.e. in a delightful reverence for the Lord. Because God has granted it. We must embrace this. The will of God has to be worked. You and I. Okay? So, that's why God will say things like, lay hands on them. Right? Somebody's sick? Lay hands. Because believers in my name, in Jesus' name, will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. Right? So He gives us something to do. Something to do. The scriptures are full of these examples where, because God has made this possible, you do this. You do this. So one of the things that covers is what we're talking about today, rejoicing. How do you handle trouble? I wish I could say otherwise, but trouble is a common feature of all of our lives. Different characteristics, of course. And one of the things that always happens is, nobody knows how bad my troubles are. Okay? Can we just agree with this? Everybody has the feeling that my troubles are worse than everybody else. It's not true, but we don't have to deny the sense of it, right? You tell me your trouble, I'm thinking, I'll take that any day. Don't be so fast to say that. That's what you're going through? Let me tell you about what I'm going through. And you know, the funny thing is, it is a scheme of our adversary to magnify our troubles. What are we doing when we say, oh, I got it even worse? Okay? Let's acknowledge, sometimes we're just looking for sympathy and pity. We just want somebody to agree, this is not right. That's all fine. But the devil wants to use it to magnify your trouble so much that you forget there is a greater God who is more than enough to take care of this. The bigger the trouble, the bigger the grace available to you. Okay? Now, in one sense, that's not a true statement. It's not like God gives grace according to the trouble. What I'm really trying to say is, there is no trouble you will ever encounter that the grace of God granted to you is already not more than enough. Okay? You will never encounter a circumstance where God has not already said, okay, let me just paint a mix up. Okay, Allison is going to encounter trouble, and I'm just going to put it in financial terms, okay? This is not to say this is what Allison's going through, because I don't know that, okay? Allison's troubles equals $15 million. God's plan is, okay, give her $60 million. That's how God is thinking about it. He's not saying, you got to keep an eye on that, Allison. Start with just give her $1,000. Let's see how she does with that. And if she does okay with that, we'll give her another $1,000. We'll just see how well she does. That is not God. Okay? That is not the God of our salvation. That is not Jesus. He gave everything. He gave everything. How does Ephesians chapter 1 start? Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has, past tense, already accomplished, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Okay? So from his economy, from his perspective, trouble? No problem. I give you more than enough. The issue now then is how we respond to that situation. Okay? We start with this. We never have to impress God to help us. Never. Never, 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 never. The wonderful side of that is, it doesn't matter how bad a mess I am in or have made, God's still willing to help me. God's still willing to help me. If you have breath, you still have time in the world. If you don't have breath, okay, then it's too late. But then on the other hand, I think you'll find that you don't care anymore. Okay? So if a person still breathes, there is help for them in the world. There is hope for them. It doesn't matter how messed up a life is, and for all the reasons that it is messed up, God will come and save you. His perspective, his way of thinking about your life is to give you more than enough, abundant grace. The scriptures describe the life that God has called us to partake in as abundant life. And the picture there is not, there's lots, it's like more than enough. You need 15 million? Give her 80. That ought to take care of things. This is God. So then, it really comes down to, how do we respond? Okay, so if $60 million is mine, where is it? I'm trying to scrape two pennies together. Where is it? What's going on? So God comes and teaches us. Okay. I don't have time to dig more deeply into this, but I will say this. You know, your life is far more significant and precious than the sum of your troubles. It's very easy for us to get lost in our life. Like, this is what happened, I gotta take care of these things. That relative doesn't like me, this is the mess I'm in. And we just get lost in it, and we don't see that what actually God has called us to and made available is something far more significant than just the sum of all of our troubles. We have troubles, we have to walk through them, they have to be repaired. They are places where the salvation of God can manifest and other people see, well, that's what God is like? That's how good he is? I know he didn't deserve that. And yet, there he is. I know that he could never have deserved that kindness. And yet, that's what God did for him. And maybe there's hope for me. Okay, so certainly, our troubles, we have to work through them. But you are much more than your troubles. You are called into a fellowship with God. You are called into a friendship with God, whereby things that go beyond the value of all the precious things on earth can be given to you. You have been granted the privilege of knowing him. So yes, we have troubles. Yes, they have to be sorted through. But never. May the Lord help each one of us to not lose sight of actually. That's just what I'm going through. What I am is a son of the Lord, son of God, a daughter of God, called into a friendship with him that allows me to see all the stuff that's in my life affected by God. All the stuff in my life affected by God. So what's my part? So he says, okay, trouble for sure coming. How do you deal with it? James, consider it all joy when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. Let endurance have its perfect result, that you might be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. Okay? The devil's agenda for trouble is destroy your life. God's agenda is, yeah, never mind him. This is a way for me to make him perfect and complete. This is a way for me to put things into his life that he would not be able to get a hold of some other way. I want to give him something. I want to give her something that will result in her being perfect and complete. That's God's perspective, okay? And God says, consider it. So on the one hand, that should be enough for each one of us to start every encounter with trouble with, oh, hallelujah, blessed be the name of the Lord. As I said to you before, and again, it wasn't my thought. Somebody, I don't remember who said it. You don't rejoice because you're joyful. You rejoice to get joyful. Okay? Rejoicing is not the consequence of being joyful. Rejoicing is the mechanism by which you enter into the joy of the Lord, which is your strength. Okay? That's why you are going to be faced with, I don't see anything to rejoice over, but I'm going to anyway. Okay? Everything that God wants to do in your life and mine is going to be by faith. So that means you're going to face your natural sense of saying, this makes no sense. The only thing to do here is to be down and be depressed and tear my hair out. But God then goes and says, no, I want you to consider all joy. Okay, so how do we do that? How do we do that? Let's take it, God gives us more help than just, do what I tell you. I told you to consider all joy, so get going. That's we have something better than that. Okay? And that's why I take you to the book of Habakkuk. Okay? Habakkuk. An interesting book in the Old Testament. Okay? I'm not sure how many people here have read the book of Habakkuk. All sorts of things can be taken from Habakkuk. Okay? But what I want to say before you is this. Habakkuk is the story. A man is having a conversation with God. Okay? And he is bothered by the fact that there's evil going on. He is bothered. Like, why is it that the innocent are oppressed? You know, like, the things that should be happening are being perverted. They're being frustrated by the wicked. Like, how are you letting this happen? Why are you letting this go? He was bothered by the wickedness that he saw and troubled by the fact that God isn't responding. Then God talks to him and says, this is what's about to happen. Okay, remember, this is set in a context. He's talking about the trouble he sees in Israel. And God's answer is, don't worry about it. The Babylonians are coming. And they are far worse than anything anyone has seen. Habakkuk is saying, that wasn't what I was thinking. That was not the answer that I was looking for. And then he begins a second dialogue and says, how can this be? How can you, like, okay, they're bad. Okay, fine, my people are bad. But these guys are far worse. How can you let this happen? And this dialogue goes on and on with God. And then God begins to reveal that there is an end coming for all of them. He is talking to Habakkuk specifically about that time period, but it is also setting the stage. Let's face it, the thought of injustice is not an Old Testament idea, right? We face it all the time. You only have to turn on the news to see examples of things that should not be happening. People who should be doing right, doing wrong. People in power oppressing those who should be protected. It's not like an old concept. It is a current and relevant concept. And people do say, well, where is God then? Many people, again, you know, that idea of ad absurdum is the reasoning. You reason to an absurd conclusion. You say, therefore, this cannot be true. Well, people come to the conclusion, because there's evil in the world, there is no God. It is a senseless, ridiculous argument to make.
Well, if there's a God, why is there so much evil in the world?
Actually, you know what? He told you why. That there is evil is no indication that there is no God. What it is an indication of is that God is not like what you think he is.
Well, if there was a God, he wouldn't let anything evil happen.
You have not been paying attention. So the idea that is expressed in Habakkuk is relevant for today. And God says there is a judgment. Even these that are coming to sweep Israel will be overturned. It is not to say that God endorses this cycle of wickedness and then somebody else coming to overthrow them. But he takes advantage of it to deal with circumstances. And he says there's something even better coming. Okay? So here's Habakkuk. Not complaining, but tormented by why is there injustice? God answers him with an answer that he didn't think was all that good. And then God gives him another answer. And his reaction, when all is said and done, is what we read from Habakkuk. Okay? So the context for what we're about to read again is, I've just been told the worst news that I could ever hear. Something is going to happen that I cannot imagine and fathom. But I'm also told that at the end of it, God will bring about something so fabulously wonderful. I can't see it yet. But it will surely come to pass. It will surely come to pass. It will surely come to pass. Partway through this, God tells Habakkuk, write this down. Okay? Write down what I'm about to show you. Write down what I'm about to show you. Because even though it seems to be taking time, it is surely coming. Let me put it in a different way. Even though the working out of salvation in your life seems to be taking a lot of time, it is surely coming. It is surely coming. Okay? I wouldn't have to go to Habakkuk to back that up. We can go to many different places in the scriptures that say and reveal God will faithfully save you. Don't be distracted by what you're going through in the immediate. So Habakkuk gives us an example of considering it all joy when you encounter various trials. Why would Habakkuk say this? Though the fig tree should not blossom and there be no fruit on the vines, though the yield of the olive should fail and the fields produce no food, though the flock should be cut off from the field and there be no cattle in the stalls. Okay? Remember, the context here is an agricultural society. What did he just say? Even though everything falls apart, I can't get help anywhere. Even though that's how it seems, yet I will exult in the Lord. I will rejoice in the God of my salvation. The Lord God is my strength, and he has made my feet like hinds' feet and makes me walk on my high places. What a marvelous and wonderful response to trouble. Basically, what he's saying is, even though this is how things look, I have a word from God that tells me how it's really going to be. So I rejoice. Even though my eyes tell me one thing, God has told me how things really are. Salvation is coming. Things are going to be put right. It's coming. So I will rejoice. I will exalt. The idea there is more than I'll be happy. Oh, that's not a bad thought. It's this idea of spinning around violently under the influence of emotion. I will just party over the Lord because God is faithful. This is how we are to consider it all joy. That's not me. I'm sure that's not me. Want to call the speaker? So, how do we consider all joy? It is not just grin and bear it. I mean, come on. How much grinning and bearing can any one of us do, really? You know, grinning and bearing it doesn't often touch the heart, which is where you live from, right? Grinning and bearing it is an external reaction. God wants you to consider it all joy in the inner parts. How do you do that? It must be fueled by something God has said. You have to go back to what God has said. And use that, your reaction to that has to be, so I rejoice in the face of this. You are telling me my life is going to be troubled. Well, I defy that with what God has said, and I just give thanks. Hallelujah. Have you ever been in a circumstance where something terrible has happened? And you know what? A lot of that churning happens inside, doesn't it? And a person can get quiet and moody and sorrowful and just burdened down. In that circumstance, if that ever happens to you, I hope it never does. I suspect it already has, but nevertheless, being of good cheer here, if that happens to you, you know what I encourage you to do? Take a moment and just say, Hallelujah! Out loud. Maybe do that when nobody else is around. You might startle somebody. But defy it! You're pushing me around as if God is not going to help me, but God says he will faithfully save me. He who believes in him shall not be disappointed. The one who believes in Jesus shall not be disappointed by him. This is the revelation from Scripture. And as we've talked before, you know, in your own circumstance, as you walk these things out, you need to have places in the Word that you can quickly run to and bring up. You need to have places, because let's face it, there are times when something happens and it's so out of left field that you're thrown by it. And if you have to take time, okay, let me research the Scriptures here to see what would be the most appropriate response. You're going to be steamrolled. You have to have something ready at hand. And even if it doesn't seem to be the most appropriate, the essence of it is this. God has spoken. I don't care what else, anything else says. God has spoken, and I elevate that. Your life is a mess. Hallelujah. God has set his love upon you. He set his loving kindness upon you. There's an interesting passage here in Habakkuk. He makes me to walk on my high places. He puts me in a place that I could not deserve. And grants me the privileges thereof. I could not deserve to be there. The Psalms say, he scoops me up from the ashes and sets me amongst the princes of his people. I who could never deserve these things. This is the language the scriptures paint about the favor of God coming to help. And you need to violently rejoice in view of it in the face of your circumstances. All of your troubles have to be met with, but God has said, and I just give thanks. I give thanks. I give thanks. I don't know if you would consider yourself a cheerful person normally. You know, there are some people who are just always happy and whistling and all that kind of stuff. And then there's the rest of us. Do not allow this world to define you. You are a son or a daughter of the living God. He gets to say who you are. And you are a creature made to rejoice. It is not normal for the saint to be depressed. It happens, agreed, but it's not normal. I.e., that's not what should be happening. That is not the normal thing. Did you notice that water normally runs downhill? You know what I mean? Right? Water doesn't say, okay, I'll run downhill today. No, it's normal nature. The normal thing is for it to run downhill. The normal thing for you, even though it may not seem that way, you have been made to rejoice in the face of trouble. God is instructing us about how the son, the daughter of God, to whom everything has been granted, needs to work things out in trouble. Here's your first step. Of course, you're going to have to make choices. Of course, there may be forgiveness required. Of course, there may be hard work involved. And all of those things, God is dealing with different parts of our life that need to be repaired. Fine. Your first reaction has to be, oh, hallelujah, Father. I hate this, but I love you. I hate this, but I thank you that you've already provided for it. And there is a treasure for me to get here. Help me to get it. Help me to get it. Who loves the trouble that we face? Who loves having a heart attack? You're in a bizarre place if you think, oh, I just love the fact that I had trouble. We don't love trouble, but we love God and what he will do for us in the trouble. And that has to fuel our response to things. Okay? So the ball is in your court. Stop saying, God's supposed to take care of this. God has taken care of it. He's waiting for you to take it up. Take hold of it. Are you sick? Reach out to the Lord for it. But start with a rejoicing. Oh, Father, I thank you. I feel so bad. I feel terrible. I think I'm going to die. But you said, by his stripes, I am healed. And I thank you that in the face of what I am suffering, you are faithful. Even if things don't get turned around right away, this much you know, God says rejoice. He's telling you, he's telling the one whom he loves how to get through this. How to get through this. It may be counterintuitive to how the world works, but he's never wrong. Do you know why you should believe God and what he says in his word? Because he's never wrong. It's not because, well, we're good Christians and we're supposed to make God look good. Even though, my goodness, he says these stupid things. But nevertheless, we'll just make him happy. We don't want anybody saying bad things about God. So we'll believe this stupid stuff like that he loves us always. No. Believe it because it's true. Rejoice always. Consider it all joy. Not because, okay, then I'll make him happy with me. Do it because it's true. It's right. It's the good thing to do. Ah, Father, even though everything about me says this is now the time to scream my head up and complain, you say there is something precious for me to get here, so I'm going to deliberately choose to rejoice. I again end by emphasizing that word, consider. There is a deliberateness to that word. It is not, I hope this works out. I hope it feels this way for you. It is, whatever is going on, readjust things so that your thought is, I'll rejoice. Whatever you got to do, whatever you got to bring into your consideration, do it so that your conclusion is, oh, let's rejoice. That might take nanoseconds, that might take days, but bring yourself to the point where your reaction to trouble is, hallelujah, God, you are faithful and I will bless your name. I will bless your name in the face of this. If this takes my life, I will still have praise in my mouth every moment of my days because you are simply worthy. I will refuse to give this thing place when you are the only one worthy of my thanksgiving and my praise. That has to be how you respond to trouble. That has to be how we respond to trouble. Okay? We don't need to love trouble. Nobody should. But we love God who saves us in the face of it. Make a big deal of that. Ah, God loves me in the face of this. This is not a sign that God is out to get me. It's a sign that God is out to get me into something good. He's out to get me. It's to get me, and you know, my brother's coming from the airport. I'm going to go get him. That's not, I'm going to go get him and beat him up. I'm going to go get him and bring him to somewhere that he's supposed to be. That's what God is going to do next time. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Do you understand that if you say amen, you have a responsibility? Now you can do it, right? These are things within our grasp. God never puts something too far away from us as the instruction for our life. If he speaks it to us, it's doable. It's doable. And it's good. It's right. It's the best thing we could do. Even though we may not see it, it's the best thing we could do. It's the best thing we could do. Okay, amen.